think most of you know Michael very well, but Michael Rotondi has been practiced and taught architecture locally and internationally for over 40 years, always operating from his base in Los Angeles. He's a founding partner of Morphosis from 1975 until 1991, and then a founding principal partner of RoTo Architects from 1991 to the present. He's a co-founder of SCI-Arc, where he co-created and directed the graduate program from 1978 to 1987. And he was the second institute director from 1987 to 1997, and currently teaches as distinguished faculty. Throughout the four decades, practice and teaching have become complementary halves of one activity, growing and deploying an architectural mind that is curious, cross-disciplinary, and quintessentially problem-solving. So without further ado, it's my pleasure to present Michael Rotondi.
First time I lectured in China, I know that there's great population and huge numbers in China. And I walked into the auditorium and I look out, this must be the wrong auditorium. There's 4,000 people. And that's when I began to think about there's a difference between talking at scale. This is can be more conversational, whereas if you're talking to thousands of people, you have to be entertaining. So if any of you start following this, they were putting the show together, I was interested in knowing what they were doing, but I didn't expect to be in the show. And when April and Stacy asked me to be in the show, at first it felt a bit odd because I'm an architect and don't say that I'm an artist. And even though we talk about architecture as an art form, it's not something that we define ourselves as. And then they said, well, why don't you put your sketchbooks? Because I'll show you what some of the sampling of what's in the show, what I put in the show or in my room under the back area. I have a room in between. Stacy is here, April is here, and I'm here. I think that's a good fortune for me to be in between both of them. But time is a subject that they said this is about time, the name of the show and what the subject matter is, I asked my assistant in the office to go through all my notebooks and find whatever she could find about time. And it was just all this stuff about time going back three decades at least. And I started to think again about all of the different conversations I've had with different people and different cultures that have different concepts of time. Working with a man who was the Igbo tribe in Nigeria was the first time I ever had a conversation about ancestors being in the soil. Native Americans was a whole other experience of talking about time, which is mostly shallow time for all of us, and then the deep time, it might be you go to Death Valley and you're reminded of geologic time, which goes to billions of years instead of dozens of years. Even when being introduced, it's always still I'm not totally at ease hearing that I've done something for four decades, although I have. And that comes from many years ago, I read a book that talked, the title of the book, which was at the time, not much was written about death, and I wanted to read about death for very personal reasons, five decades ago. And the only book that I could find was a book my own death. And what it was about was the mind is infinite and the body is finite. And because of that, we're always having to come to terms when you reach a certain point in time in your life. And ever since, you know, careful choose. I think there's just there's various milestones in any of our lives where your body and your mind kind of come together and confront each other in a way that makes you begin to question the nature of your own existence. And so time has always been really an amazing subject to me, including when I started to try to understand things like complexity theory, and I started to read the philosophy of science rather than the hardcore math of science. And you discover that one of the topics, the primary subject that runs through all scientific work is time. Because time, what they're really measuring, they're looking at things that are changing. And in order for you to understand change, you need a metric, and the metric is time. So time exists by seeing things change, and change wouldn't exist without the metric of time. And so it made me, I'm always thinking about what's the architectural equivalent of whatever I'm thinking about. And virtually everything I do as an architect, time enters the picture. Now it's a fact, but I'm always, you know, when you're in a world that goes from theory to drywall, you're always thinking about what the meaning of things are. You know, so you go from the practical, you're trying to get into the poetic, and then if you're working with the right people in the right situation and you're ready, you can shift it into the profound. And that's what happens when you are able to work with people that wrap fact and fiction around each other, like the double helix. And in the world of science that we know in the Western intellectual tradition, which is one of skepticism, you don't do that. If somebody has a new idea, you gotta prove that it's right and see if you beat the crap out of it. If it basically still survives, if it's still breathing, you make a hypothesis, and then maybe it becomes a theory. Whereas when you start to meet people in, that come from the Igbo man, for instance, educated, undergraduate, Oxford, graduate PhD in Stanford, becomes basically a medical research and practitioner at SC. He asks me to design a couple of houses for him because he's moving back to Nigeria, post Biafran war stuff, and we'd have conversations. And he would say, for instance, I had a great piece of land, window in the kitchen. I say, wow, this is going to be fantastic. We can put a big window, pass me out to the yard. He goes, no, absolutely not. I go, why not? And he goes, because your enemies can will evil spirits into the food. I go, what are you talking about, man? You've been in all your education. That was the first time he had the patience to talk about the part of his mind which comes from the education in the West, and the part of the mind that comes from being raised in a tribal situation. So superstition became a whole other word. It was no longer pejorative. It was actually the fiction that we use in our creation stories. And we tend to keep our creation stories and our science apart from each other. Earth-based societies bring them together. So working hypothetically and theoretically and then ultimately trying to figure out the architectural equivalent is what ends up in my sketchbooks, usually. So they're like visual improvisations to start with. And so that's what I put in over here. And I'll tell you more about that as we keep going. But, and then preparing for the show, I was reading a lot about time. This particular physicist, the theoretical physicist, has written a number of wonderful books, but this is one of them. This particular quote comes from one of his books. And so I was curious. I mean, how could it be a world without time? Well, in the quantum world, it's a whole other deal. I've been involved with SCI-Arc for the last 8 years. Not involved doing a project for them. It's interesting. Each of them, there's divers, there's sprinters, and there's water polo. Each of them has a whole different psyche. The swimmer, basically, you talk and basically follow the line, boom, back and forth, back and forth. Their lateral thinking is present, but not when you're in a conversation about designing swimming pools. Divers basically see it this way. Water polo people have a pool, and they all have different time structures and the way they think. So, time and change here. Sketching, one of the things that I've noticed, I was asked by a neuroscientist, a brain guy, about students using their hands anymore. This was about maybe 15 years ago. And one of the things we had a conversation about over a period of 3 days at a conference was the possibility that your imagination unfolds at the rate that your hand moves. Not this, but actually that. So that I believe that's so, the speed at which my hand moves. And why I draw is it opens my mind and focuses me at the same time. And then the journaling is, I had so much fun my last year of university that I decided that I was going to write a curriculum that would last a lifetime. So that's what I've done, lifelong learning. And so I'm always reading and taking lots and lots of notes. I was sitting with a man who became a friend, a Peruvian, who every story he told me was like magic realism. And he says to me, "How old are you?" And I said, "I'm sort of, 37, going on 38. And I go, no, he didn't say it. He told me how old I was. And I asked him how he did. And he said, "Because you talk equally about the past and the future." So when he did that, I did this diagram. My son at the time and my father, my son only talked about, his stories were always about the future, and my father's stories were always about the past. That fascinated me. And then Borges is one of my all-time favorite authors. I'll just let you read this yourself. "But time is the substance I am made of. Time is the river, is a river that sweeps me along, but I am the river. Time is a tiger that tears me apart. I am the tiger. Time is a fire that consumes me, and I am the fire." And then the theme of the show, in my notebooks, I found lots of things like this. I was always puzzled how time could be an arrow and a cycle. And then it dawned on me that when you look at a line that you draw through a microscope, it's not straight. It's all kind of crazy. And then I started thinking about that maybe the time's arrow, when you zoom in, it's basically all a series of loops. And so, in fact, that's what it is. So time's arrow and time cycle. And then there's deep time and shallow time. The deep time, which was discovered, which was written about in a way that is considered to be the first time that deep time, which is geologic time, was written about, was Stephen Jay Gould in a book that April was reading when the show was talked about and conceived. And basically, deep time is billions of years. Shallow times are events in our lives, as well as it could even go up to millions of years. But when you go to deep time, it's almost incomprehensible, and it can be when you go beyond a certain distance. Okay. And then I just thought I'd show you the process. The creative process is really both an arrow and a cycle, because you do a lot of iterations, but you're trying to move a project forward, and that's really a lot of fun. So, and there's lots of more sketches, but I thought I'd throw these in here. These were just trying to figure out what goes in the room, and then had some wonderful conversations with Stacy about the first too much stuff and then how to put it in there. That was pretty great. And then this was when we finally were able to install it. And when I asked, "What can I put in there?" they said, "Sketchbooks." And I said, "Okay, I got a vitrine and a table that I could bring over and stuff in it. And they said, well, why don't you put other stuff in it? Because I have a table at the office that are all the things that I've saved over time that I just want to be reminded of. And a lot of it has to do, there's a lot of soil. There's objects, and I'll show you some close-ups of it. The first time I understood that there was a relation between time and change was when I was trying to sort out, I was totally confused when we founded SCI-Arc, which is a school of architecture for you who don't know. We left the university to start our own school because it was an anachronism to think about what we'd blow up. 1972, post-60s, wanting to start our own school. When you're very young, you can say things like that because you don't know what you're talking about. But that's an age when anything imaginable is possible. So I wanted to try to understand. I was confused about what alternative education was because no one ever talked about it. And I thought, okay, I'm going to do a project, but I'm going to go into my confusion and then work my way back out. And it was it prepared me for being an educator and for ultimately, you know, learning to run a school. But it's always about change. Change is essential to all, it's an evolutionary imperative and it's a biological necessity. In our institutional structures, we tend to make the structure too heavy. And it basically either slows down or it stops change. And that's not a good thing. That's not a good thing. So buildings have to change. It's you have to make it possible for a building and an institution that is proposing that the students are thinking in ways that make them ultimately hyper-creative. Everything has to change. It changes at different rates, but it all has to change. And it usually doesn't. So on the floor, that's a phrase that I didn't know. Tracy said, on the floor is anything that's not on the wall. When I first heard that, I was like, on the floor. But anyway, there's in the latrine are these things here. I've collected soils ever since I was told by one of the elders of the Lakota tribe that I was working with that the memory of the ancestors are in the soil. And if you want to understand the stories that are being told to you, go to this particular spot in the Black Hills, get the soil, and just rub it slowly in your hands. And the memory of that soil might picture your body and your mind. And so wherever I went around the world, I kept collecting soils. And the people said, how do you get them in? That was pretty easy, actually. You just rub some soil on a pair of underwear, and when they used to open up your suitcase in the middle of days before global entry, they'd open up my suitcase and they'd see like brown on a pair of white chalky shorts. Okay, you're good to go. Yeah. And they didn't know that. I got caught once though. Something was sticking out. They gave me a lecture like, what if everybody brought soil? What if everybody brought soil? No one needs soil. But anyways, I've kept all my cell phones and a variety of other objects. So this is in the case out there. There's even bigger cell phones and a lot of other communication devices that I've kept that aren't here. But I thought these were my favorite. And then the soils go from white to black, and then in between there's browns and reds and greens. It's pretty amazing how soil, those are the range of colors wherever you are in the plant because of the minerals that are in the soil. So. And then I keep objects like the turtles are basically the earth in indigenous cultures. And then my little character, the homie, he travels the world with me. The friend here, Orhan, took a number of the photos that he asked me for a number of the photos, and he wrote a really nice essay about them. The elephants from India, one of the things. And then this, the sampling of some of the sketchbooks. When I'm writing, the pen or the pencil and the paper are essential to put me into a certain state of mind, or to I choose them based on the state of mind. And there really is a transaction, which is the kind of resistance you feel when you're using a soft lead pencil, or you're using a fountain pen, or you're using a rapidograph, or a felt tip. They're all this is a project where I'm thinking about a lot of things simultaneously, and this is the way I take notes, like this. I don't do that, 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 that. So however it comes out, or to be exploring a subject and trying to visualize. This is what Rudolf Arnheim would call visual thinking. This one, I was listening to a piece of music, and then I'll listen to a piece of music by different people over time. And there's a period that starts in the 50s and 60s where music notation became as interesting as the music being played. And so this one, the guy wanted each person who was playing it to play it differently depending upon what their interests were. So you follow these lines and the music comes out differently. So I decided as I was listening, I would try the diagram, and that's what came out. Another downloading projects, and each one has different time duration. Ah, these are fun, actually. This, I have bigger notebooks that I use. I start them in August, and then I start downloading everything that I want to teach for the next year, and they come out like this. And everything that I'm going to do in a studio for teaching are in these. And these take about 3.5 months to fill up with all of the stuff. But they're really a lot of fun. Ah, April and I were just in Mexico City. We're in San Miguel de Allende in Mexico City, and we're there with Garland for the wedding. And didn't know what to do on the bus. And the bus is bumpy. So I decided, I got these little index cards, and I decided if I take my copy pen, I just try to draw straight lines for an hour. And this is trying to draw straight lines for an hour, right here. So this is the bus ride, index of the bus ride. On the roll. These accordion books, the Japanese, I call them J accordions or J fold, but they're Japanese accordion books that I can work on for quite a long period of time. This one I started, I think, 7 years ago, and then put it on the shelf, and then I got it out for the show and kept working on it and finished it. And, there's two sides to it, which are really a lot of fun. That's a bit of a close up. And then this I decided that I became interested in the possibility of I heard a man lecture on Miles Davis, who was a music theorist at Yale. All he talked about was time loop, and that fascinated me. So I started to think about, is it possible to design? We're always looking for rule sets in order to make as a basis for making choices in a building, especially if you're never trying to repeat yourself. So we decided to set some rules based on basically the major third, as it's called, 5-4. So every 5 feet and every 4 feet, there's an increment. And then there's also diagonal lines that go basically vertically as well as horizontally. And then each one of those lines is given a certain value. There's a hierarchy of making choices. So like where a window begins and ends, where a wall begins and ends. So it's a way of developing complexity in a building, but not having it be totally impromptu. This particular client was interesting because he surprised me, because when he was talking to me about what he does, I was doing his diagrams, but really they look like a network. And so I asked him if we could do a house that takes the complexity that he's talking about and put it into a house. And he said, yeah. He goes, it's going to be strange to my eyes. And I said, yeah. He says, can you make it familiar to my body? And I said, absolutely. And then had to figure out what he meant by that. So this is the plan of that same building. So these are all the increments. This is a close-up of where the two different wings come together. And these take months to figure out and draw and redraw and redraw. So this here is one of many, many drawings, just trying to figure out what approach. And then you finally end up with that. I'll show you a few buildings, even though there's no buildings shown over there. pretty dangerous to try to do buildings that you say are based on complexity, because you could end up with a pile of stuff. This one turned out really well, and other projects that I would put in the experimental category. So architecture and time. The ultimate test of an architectural idea is to construct it, which takes time. Conception, creative speculation, and construction. Time is invention when buildings actually come to life. How form intercepts light and shapes it is critical. How form, light, and space guide the movements of people and things. And then our project symbolically and materially inflates past, present, and future. And even in a temporary building, you're always thinking of precedent. And then that's always present in some way, either paraphrasing or abstracting something that you know from history, brought into the building. But at the same time, it's how does somebody live in it in the present? And then you're trying to project forward in order for the next generation to try to mine it and find things. All of that is, so time is really essential. The 10 by 10 book, I made my own sketchbooks. I would make my own sketchbooks. There's one in particular that's in the show in there. And there's one that's open to a certain page of a case, and then what's on the wall are reproductions of the pages that you might see if you were able to turn the pages. So these have a lot of the same things in them, but they're a way of establishing, getting ideas written down, translating the ideas into certain kind of images, and then having certain things that remind you of the metrics that we're always working with. And then there's postcards. If you unfolded this, there'd be the written part of this. Period when my son was young, 11, 12 years old, I decided that I would send him postcards as I did to my mother, wherever I was. And so I found blank postcards in Kyoto, and I decided that I'm going to basically fill up a set of like 10 pages of these postcards on a trip. And then I came back, and instead of sending them, I would give him the book. And then sometime later, he gave me all the books back. He asked me, he said, "I'm going to give these back to you, but I want them back." I said, "When?" He goes, "After you die." So he said, so we put it in our will that he gets all the notebooks. But there would be things that we were talking about before I left, and then I would try to figure out how to do drawings that might carry on the conversation when I return. And so that's what these are. And then timepieces, places I've been and things that I've seen and objects that I've always been inspired by. April and I happened to be in the Devon Plains on our way to St. Ives at the time when they reopened Stonehenge. And it looked like there was a deadhead concert because of all of the VW buses. But it was people, and I said, "What are they doing there?" And it turned out that they were all going to Stonehenge for the new ceremony. All the years that I've read about Stonehenge, it's pretty amazing how an object can basically embody all of the knowledge that is known at that particular time to help people navigate their daily lives, but at the same time navigate the GPS if it goes beyond that into the spiritual realm. So it shifts completely into cosmology. And that's something that we've not done, we've not been interested in, but we tend to stratify all of the different areas of our life. And from this period forward, creation stories, cosmologies, whatever way you define them, are embodied in either the architecture or the landscape itself. Time continuum, working with Tibetan Buddhists, this, you take the middle of it and lift it up and it becomes a temple. And that's, I didn't know, I was not even two-dimensional. And so we ended up working with the temple, with them on the temple. And then watching them do these sand paintings, pretty extraordinary. And then Feng Shui, I have a real little Lupin in the show. This is a drawing of one, just so you can sort of decipher and see how it works. It can basically just tell you the cardinal directions, but then there's all these other ways of reading it to determine the placement of things, the size of things, the proportion of things. And then in Wyoming, the medicine wheel, which is pretty amazing, it's still there. And then incremental time with the pendulum. This is at the one at the Griffith Park Observatory. We grew up spending a lot of time up there, fascinated that this is really, what it's doing is indexing that the Earth is moving, and you just can't visualize it except when you see each one of these things be knocked over. And then in Chaco Canyon in New Mexico, Pueblo Benito, all the things that have been said that this was constructed for, everything in Chaco Canyon intercepts the sunlight in a way that allows them to tell time. Eons all the way down to shadows moving to tell them things that need to be done at certain times of year. So usually give them a breakdown to seasons. But this particular building has really great potential. And then an orrery, which we used in a restaurant. We didn't use this in a restaurant. We used the whole notion of an orrery, of an object that is used to tell time. And then these we used to have to draw by hand when we were students. Now there's software that does all of this. But to really understand the cycles of the sun throughout the year are I always love looking at drawings that have a geometric component to it. In the case of all of the information that can be put into a drawing. These are usually the basis of inspiration. A number of us, he was curating putting the show together, and he wanted all of us to put down something right at the end of, well, I don't know if it was at the end, it's not never the end of COVID, but this was the COVID time. Then working with the Lakota Sioux, as they're commonly called in South Dakota, we were able to listen to elders for 6 months before we started designing anything. And one of